Good morning. God is good. All the time, God is good. It's great to see you here in your homes for another week of worship. We have a very special worship experience planned for you today. I'm going to call us together in worship in a moment in prayer. And then following that, we'll have a hymn to sing. And I encourage you to go ahead and sing it. No matter how loud you are, you're at home. And so those of you who are afraid to sing in church, you don't need to worry about that. You can go ahead and do your very best and your neighbors won't hear you, so it won't be a problem. Then we'll also have a message for the children, and then following that, a message for the adults. And then finally, we'll have communion, a brief little service. So I invite you to go ahead and to get yourself some juice, and some bread, and be prepared for that. You can pause this video at any point. So in the meantime, I hope that you are feeling as excited as I am to try this new way of worshiping together until we come together in our church service. So in the meantime, let us turn to God in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for bringing us together today in this very different way. We ask your Holy Spirit to be present with us, to encourage and strengthen us. Give us hope and hopefulness for the future, for we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Let us worship Almighty God.
Alone, I hope.
morning, boys and girls. I have a message for you specifically that I wanted to share with you today. I don't know about you, but I remember back when my kids were young, one of our favorite books was a book called Where's Waldo? Now, Waldo was a character who was painted into this picture book, and he was hard to see because he was painted in, but he was always the same image. He always had the same cap on his head, and if you had to hunt for him, you could find him if you were very careful at that. So Where's Waldo became a very important thing in our children's lives as they were growing up, and then everywhere we went, when we were missing something, we'd ask, Where's Waldo? Where's Waldo? Well, in many ways, we're missing a lot of the things that make us feel comfortable in our lives. We're missing being able to go to school. I know you kids are really missing that. I know your parents are missing it even more than you are. And we're also missing opportunities to play sports, to go out to parks, and to do other things that we're used to doing. But most especially, from my perspective, we're missing the opportunity to gather together as the whole church and to worship and praise God and to learn more about Him in Sunday school. We're blessed that Brittany is being able to put together a children's Sunday school program for Zoom meetings, and that's going on. And we know that we are looking forward to getting back together again. But I can tell you right now that as pastor of the church, it's important to remind everybody, not just you young people, but everybody, that the church exists far beyond the walls of the sanctuary. It exists in our homes. It exists in the way that we love each other and express God's love for us in Jesus Christ in that way. And so it's in that spirit that I invite you to remember that God's love never ends. His love for us is always there. And even though we can't be together right at the moment, one day this will pass and we will be together again, and God will bless us in that time. So I'd like you to remember that and then pray with me if you would aloud. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for today, for food, rest, and play. We thank you for all the ways that you love us and care for us and hold us close to you. Bless our moms and dads, our grandmas and grandpas, our brothers and sisters, our neighbors and friends, and even the people in the world that we've not even met yet who are in need. Bless us this day, in Christ's name. Amen. God bless you, and have a great day. Once again, my friends, God is good all the time. I want to share a passage of scripture for today that comes from Matthew's gospel, and it is a powerful witness to God's institution of what it means to be the church and how to live that out as a faithful men and women in Christ. It comes from Matthew's gospel, chapter 16, verses 13 through 20, and I want to read it and share it with you today. So listen now for the word of Almighty God as we find it here. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, we give you thanks this morning for this opportunity that we have to worship in a different way. We pray that your blessing will be upon us as we do our best to open ourselves to your Spirit and be strengthened in your love. May your Spirit be present, Lord God, to take the words we have shared and join them together with the few that follow, to speak that one word as each of us has need to hear it. And to that end, Lord God, more than ever, I pray you give me the gift of preaching, and those here gathered, ears to hear it, and hearts to make it real. For we ask this in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. It's often hard for us to imagine in our own minds what it must have been like to be one of the early disciples who followed Jesus around. Sometimes we take comfort in the fact that the disciples were often confused and uncertain about exactly what it was that Jesus said and what he meant. Well, our scripture for today actually takes us to a place far to the north of what we often think of as Israel proper, away from Jerusalem, away from the Galilee, and up to the headwaters of the Jordan, to a place called Caesarea Philippi. Now, Caesarea Philippi was a place that was established that had a long history of pagan worship that existed there. There was a grotto, and in the midst of the grotto was the waters that would ultimately flow from the mountainside of Mount Hebron, which is where Caesarea Philippi is located. And the waters would form together there and begin the first trickles that would lead ultimately to the waters of the Jordan River, which traversed the length of the nation of Israel. Now, you remember that that place was also a place that was a place that was used for pagan worship. And it was considered by the Jews to be one of the most unholy places, if not the most unholy place you could go. And so it's strange that after Jesus has had encounters with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, he decides that it's important to take his disciples on a journey to this place. And it is there in, if you will, with the backdrop of this grotto and the religiosity that existed in the pagan world right behind them and the strength of that, that he has the conversation that he had that we read in Scripture just a few moments ago. In it, he has a conversation with his disciples, and he asks them the question that was certainly on everyone's mind who had ever seen Jesus or heard about Jesus or who had the opportunity to talk and be with Jesus. Who exactly is Jesus, was the question. Now, there were many answers that were given in the culture around them. Some thought that he was a prophet who had come from God to send a message to people, maybe like Elijah to prepare the way for a Messiah, or John the Baptist, for example, who would also come to prepare the way of the Lord, as we understand it from the New Testament writings. And many others were simply confused about who this rabbi, this carpenter converted into a teacher, was actually about and who he was. And so you could well imagine and understand that there was a great deal of confusion and uncertainty and a lot of hubbub and conversation about it. Well, Jesus wasn't apparently too concerned about what other people thought, but he was very interested in what he thought his disciples believed about who he was and what he was about. And so in this context then, surrounded, if you will, by a lot of pagan worship and the context of the control and the oppression of the Roman Empire around them, Jesus asked them, "Who do you say that I am?" And it is in that context that they go through the litany of the other suggested names, and finally Peter declares that he is, in fact, the Messiah. And it's in that moment of time that something absolutely fantastic happens. Now, many of us think that the birth of the church happened on the day of Pentecost, after Jesus had been raised from the dead, after he'd spent time with his disciples on earth, and then ascended into heaven. But the real truth of it is the actual establishment, if you will, of the church began here in this place, outside and surrounded by this kind of pagan culture, the most anti-God space you could possibly find. When Jesus made the declaration that the disciple named Simon, son of Jonah, who was the fisherman we now know as Peter, got his name Peter, which is from the word Petra. We understand it as meaning rock. And Jesus declares that Peter, Simon the rock, would be the foundation upon which the church would be founded. Now, that's a remarkable thing if you think about it, because many things were going to have to transpire between this point in time and the time in which the church would get up and running doing its work in the world. One of the most profound aspects of it is that in the conversation with Peter and the rest of the disciples who were there who heard him say these things, he affirmed his messiahship. He made sure that they understood that they were going to be built on Peter as their leader, as the central rock upon which the church would ultimately be constructed, but that they were being put together, gathered together for a reason. And it wasn't merely just to have a place to go, but that they would be a people purpose. Let me explain why I say that. You need to understand that in Greek, the word that it was translated from the Aramaic that Jesus most certainly spoke when he was talking to the disciples, gets translated out a word named ecclesia. This is where we get the term ecclesiastical to mean church-like things. And ultimately, that word ecclesia became known as church. It went through a lot of permeations in the Latin to ultimately get to that. But nevertheless, that's where we get the word church. But we need to understand that the original word and the original meaning of what Jesus was talking about had little to nothing to do with buildings or sanctuaries or cathedrals or anything like that. The word ecclesia literally means a gathering of people for a purpose. Now, what's remarkable about that is that Jesus is suggesting that he's going to create a movement. He's going to build a movement founded on Peter as the leader, the rock, but built around the notion that the people of God would gather around the idea of following Jesus in doing his work of inauguration of the kingdom of heaven in the world through their gathering together and their work together. Now, that's an incredible idea when you think about it, because what it means is that it doesn't really matter where you're located, but it matters what you're about and what you're doing. Rather than using the term ecclesia in the context of a home, for example, a house, he was talking about it in terms of a gathering of people together to make a home. The more common use of the term at the time was to describe gatherings that would be, for example, of soldiers gathering together to go on military campaigns, or the common populace to gather together in an arena or to watch some games, or to participate in a lecture, or maybe to just simply go someplace in which they gathered to eat. But in all of these contexts, they had a purpose for why they were gathering together. And that attitude is the attitude that literally permeated the whole of the church from the very beginning for the first 300 plus years. Let me explain why I say that. You need to understand that at the time that the church began moving forward into the world, which is the day of Pentecost as we understand it, it is at that point in time that they have no place to gather except for in small contexts within homes. At the very least, they had some opportunities as time went on in some places, in cities, for example, that were favorable to the Christian message, to be able to gather in a designated room that may have been set up in some large structure or some home, where they could occasionally gather together in larger numbers than they usually did. But generally speaking, it was a home-to-home mission. In fact, it says that in the book of Acts, that the early days of the church began and was founded in actually meeting in homes and not in any grand sanctuary or cathedral. It wasn't until 300 years had transpired and a whole lot of history of being oppressed and and persecuted and chased by the powers and the authorities that did not want the message of Jesus Christ and the good news of what God was doing through him in the world to bring about his kingdom to be known. And they were struggling constantly, always against the pressures of the world to get the message out, but the message got out. And so much so that by about 300 years in the Roman Empire, even Constantine, who was an emperor, decided that the Christian faith had become so pervasive in the culture, in the subtext of it, that he declared that the Roman Empire would be heretofore a Christian empire. And it was at that point in time that he began to do some things, and those who were in power around the throne began to do things that transformed and changed the church in very dramatic ways. Eventually, the kind of attitudes that the people who were in power had about the Christian faith often included many of their attitudes that existed in their pagan worship that had preceded it. And so they began to dedicate spaces, temples, worship spaces that had been used for pagan purposes for now Christian purposes. The worship of God, which originally was very simple, gathered around common meals. We call them agape meals. They were fellowship meals of love where they shared together the bounty of what they could bring together to eat. And then in addition to that, they would also bring together opportunities to read the early letters of the church, to read the scriptures of the Old Testament, to talk about them and talk theology with each other. It's hard to believe that they actually had theological discussions in those days. Many of them couldn't read, but they would hear these words read aloud and they would ponder them and they would pray together and they would give thanks to God in hymns and songs that they would sing. And all of these things would happen in their homes. And it's a remarkable thing that the church grew to be so pervasive that it ultimately took over a nation. But as can sometimes happen, even when the church grows in a certain place, sometimes the place can take over the church. And that's often what happened in the rest of the history of the Christian church, even to today. So what occurred was that ultimately many people started to associate church with the space, with the place, with a sanctuary or a cathedral or something like that, rather than focusing on their ecclesiastical purpose, the gathering for the purpose of sharing the good news of Jesus Christ and going out into the world to do his work. Well, in these pandemic days when we are kind of trapped in our homes, it's easy to understand why we can get frustrated and feel uncertain about what we are doing as the church. The reality is we have the same opportunity that the early church did. It's kind of like church the old-fashioned way. It's a way in which we can get back to the basics. We can focus, if you have children in your home, focus on teaching your children how to pray, how to read scripture and to listen to it and to grow in strength from it. It's an opportunity where we can try to think up service projects that we can do that will make better their lives, the children's lives, our families' lives, and the people around us, so that we're prepared that when the day comes and we can open our doors and go and be joined together again, we have something to do. It's also an opportunity for us to realize how dependent we are on God and His grace and each other, praying for one another, constantly focusing our attention on the needs of those who are less fortunate, helps us to remember why we have been gathered by Jesus to do his work in the world. I remember one time, way back when I was a young student in ministry, I had the opportunity to serve in a church that was called First Memorial Presbyterian Church. Well, I have to tell you, it wasn't the first Memorial Presbyterian Church ever established, but it very much was a hallmark of what that name ultimately represented. The memorial came many years after the church had been established, and it had done quite well for many years, grew in great strength, and a huge edifice, lots of financial resources. It was a place that was the center of all ministry in that community in which it was placed. But over the years, as time went on, the world around it changed, and the church leadership didn't want to. And they got focused on the external things of church, kinds of things that ultimately don't build the kingdom, but build up buildings and edifices and attitudes instead. And so what happened was, by the time I got there, the church had fallen into great disarray. Its numbers had dwindled, and it ultimately had lost sight of its purpose for why it gathered. Gone were the heady days in which they were the most important church in the community and the surrounding area. And now, now they depended upon the grace of God to find a new path. Blessedly they did. And slowly but surely they began to regain their claim on why they were there. And they started to care about the people in the community in ways that made a huge difference. I'd like to suggest to you that we don't worship our church or the sanctuary. We love it. We care for it. We tend to it. We maintain it very well. We take care of it as good stewards. But our purpose for having it is to use it as a staging area for us to gather together, prepare our hearts and minds, worship our God, not just so we can feel better for the week, but so we're strengthened for the week in the work that he puts before us ahead. And it's in that context that I call each one of us in this time of separation to remember that while the doors of the church may be shut and locked, our hearts are not. God wants us to continue to hold our hearts open, to continue to pray for one another, to be mindful of his word, to grow in strength from it, and to be prepared to go out into the world and to do the work that he wants us to do, so that we may make a bold and a dramatic statement that the purpose of the church has remained the same. It is a gathering of God's people to do God's work the old-fashioned way. Would you pray with me? Most holy God and Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing upon us in this time we've shared together. May your word feed us and strengthen us and encourage us to go forward in faithfulness. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And now I invite you to join together with the whole of the church as we take communion. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, gathered his disciples around him, and as he sat at table, he took the bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise also, after they had supped, our Lord took the cup, and he poured it out, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink of it, for this is the new covenant which is poured out in my blood for the remission of sins. Drink all of it and remember me." And we who minister in his name now offer this same gift to all of you. Let us pray. O Lord God, bless the eating and the drinking of this cup, that we may show once again that your love for us is never ending. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now taught my heart. the sun forbear to shine.